Hey, listen, one of my dear, 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 dear friend is on the call today. He's over in his third house, but that's one of his homes in Arizona. He has a home here in Vegas on the Strip. He has another house up here in Mount Charleston, which is fantastic. Drop dead gorgeous, and it's beautiful. And it's got mountain lions right around. I mean, anyway, it's up in snow country. So he has three homes he lives between. His first book came out, and he talked about me in this. It's called Beach Money. And yes, Beach Money. And then he came out on another book, Better Than Beach Money. Dear friend of mine, you've heard him before. He's been a while since being on the call. I know some of you in the leaders been asking, when are you gonna get Mr. Jordan Allen back? When are you gonna get him back? Well, I've tracked him down, and he's stationary up in his place. Matter of fact, he's having a cigar Zoom for some heavy hitters tomorrow. And I thank God that anyway, let's get down to business. Without further ado, let's give a warm welcome, my dear friend, Mr. Jordan Allen.
All right, Al.
Yes, sir. Hey, good having you to call. You're up in Jerome, aren't you?
I'm up in Jerome. Jerome's an old, if you haven't heard of Jerome, it's right near between Sedona and Prescott on the mountain. It's an old ghost town. There were 15,000 miners here in the 1800s, early 1900s, and now there's about 500 residents. And it's a nice little town with a lot of artists and musicians. They say we've got a let's see, we've got a an A drink in town with an artist problem is what they say.
Well, guys, I have been invited so many times up there, and I have not made it up. I have to apologize. I have not made it up in all these years. You've
Al,
had
you
that
got to
place.
come up. It's great. It's great.
I know you've had that place, what, 25 years?
25 years. Yeah.
Yeah,
Yeah.
yeah, yeah. And he's been asking me, and I've just been a bad friend. Just been busy out there blowing and going, and
Yeah.
he's one. Go ahead.
You're too busy going to the Turks and Caicos and Panama and Colombia and all that.
Well, like I said in the call yesterday, somebody's got to do it. And
Yeah.
I wish a lot of my leaders on here, they're going to start doing more of that this year and next year with inspiration from you today. And we've been friends forever. Tell a little bit about your backstory. I want people to hear a little bit because we got a lot of new people. They've heard of you, and some of them have not. That's why I introduced your books. Tell everybody about you, how you got started in network marketing. Tell that story, sir.
Yeah, you bet. So I grew up in the south suburbs of Chicago. And just to give you a sense of the neighborhood that I grew up in, when my father passed away 8 years ago, we sold his home, the home that I grew up in, and it sold for $8,900. Not $89,000, not $890,000, but $8,900. That's what the house sold for when he passed away. So I grew up in a lower middle income neighborhood in the south suburbs of Chicago, two sisters. My dad saved his entire life for all three of us to go to college for 1 year, but we were required to graduate. And I got a degree in landscape architecture. And I was at a garage sale. I worked my way through college as a night clerk and a resident advisor, never took out a loan. And I picked up a book at a garage sale called The Basics by Don Faila. It's out of print. You can still get used copies of it. It's a really relevant book. About 60% of it is really relevant today. The other 30% is, or 40% is not. Anyway, the book taught me residual income and leverage. And I'd never heard of it before, didn't know what it was, didn't really care what anybody else thought. I got excited about it. Right out of college, I had 250 bucks in birthday gifts and a guitar and a suitcase, and I moved to Arizona where I knew one person. Right from Chicago, I moved straight to Arizona and worked lots of odd jobs, renting roller skates and working at a gym. And I got a job as a draftsman for 12 grand a year. And I started dabbling in different entrepreneurial endeavors. I started answering ads in the newspaper. And over the next 10 years, I got involved in 11 different network marketing companies. I liked the idea of being able to get paid over and over and over again for working once. That was my dream. And then also, I liked the idea of leverage. You know, if you don't have a lot of money to invest to get the leverage through money, the way you do it is you do it through time by the work of other people. And so I started getting involved in different network marketing companies. I do one at a time. I'd be in it for 2 or 3 months. I get excited, I get discouraged, and I quit. And I did it over and over and over again, 10 years, 11 different companies, and never made a penny, never signed up one person. I was living at the age of 34 years old. I was living in an enclosed garage in Tempe, Arizona. And you know Arizona, you know where the ASU campus is. And I was paying $200 a month. I was eating macaroni and cheese and tuna fish. And I owned one suit. And I had a Jeep, but it was broken down in the street for a couple of years. This was at the age of 34 years old. I had $36,000 in credit card debt on 22 credit cards. And I joined my 12th network marketing company. And that's where I met Al Thomas. And I was in that company for a few months, hadn't made any money. And my a good friend of mine, good friend of Al's as well, Jay Smith, God rest his soul, Jay and his wife Meg paid for me to go to San Francisco for an event. And I sat in the event and I watched and I listened and I took notes. Again, I'd never made a penny in network marketing at this point. I got invited to a dinner, and that's where I met Al Thomas. And there were, I don't know, eight people at the dinner, the top earners in that company. And at that time, the top earner, I don't know, was making 10 grand a month at that time. But he went on to make over $1 million a month. Al went on to make millions and millions with that company. And I sat in that dinner and I listened to these people and I thought, you know what? They're just like me. Like, I'm just like them. We have the same hardships, the same struggles. The only difference is they didn't quit and they kept going and they kept, and they stayed in a posture of learning and growing and acting. And so I walked away from that dinner thinking, if they can do it, I can do it. And I went to work, and over the next 13 years, I built a group of 250,000 customers, 85,000 distributors and a 250,000 customers. And I was with that company with Al for, and we became, I grew in the company. I ended up on the stages with Al. We became very close friends. We started doing a lot of stuff together, traveling the world together. And then that company, as you know, the reason Al's here is because that company went away. The technology became obsolete. We were highly leveraged. The company was a $1 billion network marketing company that literally vaporized in about 6 months. So my $60,000 to $80,000 a month income went to zero. And I started bleeding by about $23,000 a month. And over the course of, I went through 80 grand in 4 months, and I had plenty of equity, plenty of real estate and all that, but I couldn't keep doing it. So I joined another network marketing company. I've been with my company for 20 years. I just broke my 20-year mark. And so I've had two successes in network marketing. The first one was with my last company that you guys are familiar with, that Al was with. I was there 13 years. I made $8 million with that company, and I've made tens of millions of dollars in the company that I'm in now. So there's a lot more to the story, but that's in a nutshell. That's the 5-minute version.
Yeah, $8 million in our previous company, folks. Y'all guys hear that? He also shared what he was the number one guy in our company. That company was making, he started with $10,000 a month. If you heard that story, he just said it a minute ago. And before it said and done, he was making over, listen up, he was making over $1 million per month. Okay, I'm going to say that again. Robert Williams. He was making over $1 million per month, Agent O'Neill.
And that was in the 90s, Al.
Yeah, that's when money was worth a little bit more. Today, that'd be worth about $3 million a month with the state of inflation. So just to guys let you know, you've heard from leaders this whole week about money, money, money. Our guest speaker the other day was talking about $2.5 million a year. This we're talking about $1 million a month. Guys, I can't talk about how much I was making, but trust me, it was not too far. Let me just say that. Yeah. And what did he say? Mr. Jordan said he had 85,000 distributors. His customer base was 250,000 customer base, and he was there. And folks, I'm trying to explain to you that this stuff is network marketing. What do you say about network marketing? He was 11 different companies before he found the home. But once he found it, sat down with us at dinner. That was in the Bay Area, I believe. And he said he sat there and he said, number one, he said he kept growing. He kept what? Growing. Write that down. So that's a nugget. He kept growing. And he said the second thing, he kept learning. He kept learning. See, school is never out for the professionals. I got four books I'm reading right, which is one of the books I'm reading right now. I got two more I just ordered yesterday. And next he said, then he went to work. Then he went to what? To work. You heard that yesterday. You heard that today. We all go to work. You heard three different people on the top of the company, three separate companies. Today you're hearing from Jordan on the top of his company. Yesterday I heard a guy at the top of his company. I've been at the top of my company. You've heard them all. We all say the same thing. Keep growing. Keep learning. And then what? Keep doing what? Keep learning. Yeah. So you got to keep after, folks. And the more you do it, the easier it becomes. What would you say was a turning point for your business, Jordan, when you start making the big money? What did you start? What was a turning point for you? When did you say, aha, I got this? When did that happen for you?
My big turning point was the day that I realized that quitting doesn't work. And, you know, I heard that message over and over again. I read it in books and all that, but I never really understood it really deep down in my core. Here's what would happen. I'd get discouraged after a few months and I would quit. And then I did that for 10 years, 11 different companies, and never made a penny. And then it hit me that that's not what successful people do, because everybody has big challenges. Everybody goes through lots of periods of time where you're not motivated. That's key. You're going to be not motivated a lot. Don't make your decision whether you're going to work your business based on whether you're motivated or not. If you do that, that's a formula for failure. Because here's what'll happen. You'll work for a few weeks. You'll be really excited. Then you'll get discouraged. Then you'll get depressed. Then you'll be unmotivated. And then you stop working for a few months. And if you stay plugged in, maybe you get motivated again. And then you get discouraged again. And then you get depressed again. And this is the nature of human beings. You have to, it's almost like having children. You can't make your decisions on whether you're going to be a parent or not based on whether you're motivated to be a parent. You do it based on your commitment, right? You got a commitment. So your business is the same way. You've got to be committed to your business and work harder when you don't feel like it. And what happens when you do that, when you work a little harder when you don't feel like it, your highs become much higher. But you can never let the highs get too high, and you can never let the lows get too low. It's okay to take a half a day off. It's like Al talks about firing yourself and then rehiring yourself. That's a real key thing. Like that's real life entrepreneurship. Many of you are real life entrepreneurs. Some of you are still dabbling. Some of you are still trying it out. Some of you are just testing the waters. You can't be successful in that state of mind. It has to be a state of mind of commitment. And then also you're responsible for your own level of motivation. And if you're not motivated, it's your job. Nobody else, not anybody else, nobody else's fault. It's your job to get yourself motivated again. And there's a few things you can do that. Like you have to break your pattern. Like we all get into these patterns, right? We're like in a pattern of excitement, a pattern of action, but then we get in a pattern of depression, a pattern of discouragement. And when that happens, you got to break that pattern. Maybe that means taking a drive. Maybe that means taking a run. Maybe that means getting yourself to the gym. Maybe that means doing some deep breathing exercises. Maybe that means reviewing your goals. Maybe that means getting around some successful people. You know, maybe it means having a glass of wine and watching your favorite movie, whatever it is, but you gotta break the pattern. Whatever that pattern is, it's getting you there. Because I'm gonna tell you this, every single death in a business happens when somebody is not feeling it. Mm-hmm. I have a saying, don't ever quit on a bad day. Don't ever quit on a bad day. You're gonna have bad days. If you make a decision right now while you're feeling excited, if you make a decision right now to never quit on a bad day, when you're having a bad day, you just go and you take some action. That's another thing you can do, by the way, that I didn't mention. If you're feeling down, if you're feeling discouraged, another thing you can do is just go do some more appointments, schedule some more appointments, do some more meetings, go to a meeting, you know, jump on a training, you know, something that's going to break that pattern. That's going to get you back to. And that's a constant thing. It's not something that ever ends. It's like all the time. And when you're making 100 grand a month, when you're making 50 grand a month, in fact, let me tell a quick story.
Go ahead. I'm going to be right back. Tell the story.
All right. Paul Orbison, the guy that we were just talking about, the $1 million a month guy that we were just talking about. Paul used to say, you're going to doubt. He did it in his Kentucky accent. He'd say, you're going to doubt. He said, that's just what people do. We doubt. When you're making nothing, you wonder if you'll ever make $1,000 a month. When you start making $1,000 a month, you're going to doubt and you wonder if you could ever get it to $5,000 a month. When you get to $5,000 a month, you're going to doubt some more and you wonder if you're ever going to make it to $10,000 a month. When you get to $10,000 a month, you're going to doubt some more. You wonder if you're ever going to make it to $50,000. Same, that is normal for everyone. It's normal. When you make $100,000 a month, you maybe aren't going to doubt about that anymore, but you're going to wonder, can I keep it? Can I keep $100,000 a month? You know, now that you're making all this money, like, what do you do with it? So and Paul, you know, Paul used to say, he was Kentucky, he'd say, Pipel. I'm like, what? First couple of times I heard him say it, I didn't understand what he was saying. Pipel. Remember that Al Pipel? Pipel.
People are people. That's right.
People are people.
People are people.
Some people are going to see it. Some people are not going to see it now, but they'll see it later. And some people are never going to see it. People are people. Yeah.
Yeah. People are people.
Yeah.
It's amazing. Yeah. When my check, I remember one time, you know, you said something that I never thought about to this then. When you start making over 100 grand a month or more, you know, you're curious if you can maintain it. And I swear, I'm sitting there laughing at myself. I can't laugh at anybody but myself. I remember my check went over $100,000 a month, and then it went to 160, and then it went down to 120. And I said, God dang it, they took some money from me. You know, you start thinking about maintaining it. It's so funny, and it's relevant. It's so true. I never looked at it that way. That's the first thing I thought of. What happened? The other 30,000.
Your mood, and I don't care who you are, your mood will be dependent on what your check does that month. I mean, you get discouraged if your check goes down. You get excited when your check goes up. And that's going to happen. And it's you got to learn strategies to get yourself out of that, because it's a mess. It doesn't work. But we all go through it. You know, I've had months where my check went from 200,000 a month to 120,000 a month. And I get discouraged. I'm making 120,000 a month and I get discouraged.
Yeah.
You know? So that's normal.
Yeah, we call it the emotional roller coaster. We're making 100, 200,000, go down to 130. Oh, and then go back up to 170. Yeah. Okay. And then it goes back down. Oh, so it's an emotional roller coaster, folks. And it's all levels, Manny Peralta. It's just not at 2 or 3,000 a month. It's even at the big numbers. I mean, when you take out, when you're missing 40 grand out of a check for 1 month of life, you're like, what am I 40 grand? What did I not do, Miss Maria Estrada? And it just happened to do, you got to stay in phase one. If you get nothing, you hear Jordan Allen, he's in phase one 24/7. I'm in phase. Well, I think yesterday I showed pictures of me prospecting in the morning at 4 a.m. I'm showing you, buddy Lee, I'm in phase one. I'm always in phase one. Never get out of phase one. Would you say something? What would you say about that, Jordan?
Well, yeah, you gotta constantly reinventing yourself every day. You wake up and you start over. Like this morning, I woke up, I wasn't motivated this morning. I just felt like I didn't even want to get out of bed. I was just not motivated. But once I get up and get moving, have some coffee, you know, get into my business, and then I get excited again, you know. So that's just normal. So I do wanna mention one thing, because a question I get a lot is like, what's my biggest regret? Do you mind if I touch on that, Al?
Absolutely. Please do, sir.
Yeah. So for many years, I said I really didn't have a regret. And because if I had regrets, things that didn't go well, and I regretted that something, a decision I made or whatever, I wouldn't be where I am today. However, a number of years ago, I realized I do have one regret. So here's what happens. You start making money. You know, you're making 10 grand a month, let's just say, all right? Good, really good money, but not great money, but really, really good money, $10,000 a month, and it's residual income. Now what happens is your friends start finding out you're doing well because you got a nicer car, maybe you moved out and get a little bit nicer place, and your friends, everybody has ideas and businesses, and they start coming to you and say, would you invest with me? What happens when you start making good money, 50 grand a month, 100 grand a month, You start thinking you're smart, and you're not smart. It's figured out how to leverage yourself through the work of other people. You're not smart as far as investing. You just think you're smart. Just like professional football players, entertainers, everybody comes to them and says, I got a project I want you to invest in. So you start investing in things because it's like you're going to be Mr. Shark Tank or Mrs. Shark Tank, right? You're going to invest in things. Well, when I started making money, friends came to me that had startups and real estate partnerships and all these different things. And over the course, I made, during that $8 million that I made, I lived and paid taxes on $4 million of it, lived a great lifestyle. And the other $4 million, I invested it because I'm smart, because I'm an investor. And I invested probably in 40 different projects, a movie, some nightclubs, lots of real estate stuff. And honestly, after 10 years of investing that $4 million, guess how much was left of that $4 million? Almost zero. Almost zero. 40 different projects. The reason is because I was not a knowledgeable investor. It's easier to make the money than it is to keep the money. Now, here's my regret. My regret is that I didn't follow the advice that's written in The Richest Man in Babylon, which is probably a book that you've all read. If you haven't, you should read it. It's a short, easy book to read. I knew that, but I never did it. What is that? 10% of your income. If you make $100, it's $10. If you make $1,000, it's $100. If you make $10,000, it's $1,000. And you take that money and you put it away somewhere in a conservative interest-bearing account, and you don't touch it or look at it no matter what. No matter how bad things get, you never touch it, you never look at it. But every check you get, you won't miss it. Every check you get, you're 10% away. Well, 20 years ago, after I lost that $4 million, 20 years ago, I started doing that. And you just do it for 10 years and you'll be blown away as to how much money you have. If I had just done that, if I had just taken 10% of my income from my first 13 years of success, I would have 20 million more in the bank if I had just done that. So that's my regret. Just do that. It's simple. It's something anybody can do. You won't miss that 10%. You won't miss it. You know, if you're making $2,000 a month right now, you should be putting 200 before you pay your taxes, before you, your expenses, put $200 away. Yeah. And if you do, you won't miss it. You think you miss it, but you won't miss it. And then don't touch it no matter what. Very simple. Super simple.
It's so simple that people miss it because it's too doggone simple. There's nothing sexy about it, but it works. I'm going to kind of get out in the weeds with this a little bit, off track a little bit. But I remember you guys are getting some more stuff and some juicy stuff today. I remember when Pat Hintz, I know I see Mr. Curtis Evans online. He remembers Pat Hintz. Was doing a lot of investing up in Ohio and and I remember you guys bought a bunch of houses. You called me and told me up in Minnesota and up in that area, and I went out because of what I did. I kept putting money 10% to 20% of my money away every month, because it was a larger. I bought 18 houses and I paid cash for them. Now this blows people's minds, but I tell them I've never seen either one of those houses that I bought that I paid cash for in Cleveland. So in Cleveland, Ohio, I actually own 18 houses. To this very day, I've never seen any cash flow. And I held on to it 3 or 4 years. And because I put money away, I sold them all at a nice little healthy profit. Because that's
how you know what I did. I did the same thing within the past 10 years. I bought 49 houses.
Yeah.
And you're the one. I paid cash.
Yeah, pay cash for them. Because you're the one that called me and say, hey, man, Pat's got something going on and I'm buying up here. And now we're over in Ohio. And the last time we took the private jet, the other guy, what's his name used to run, his partner handled all my rentals up there. What was his name? You took the private jet here in Vegas, took a bunch of guys down to
the brothers?
Huh?
The brothers in Seattle? I don't remember their names.
Yeah. Well, anyway,
Dan Gottesman?
Not Dan Gottesman. When you had about a year ago, you had a group here. You were taking a private jet down to Southern California, and I went out to go off with you. I can't think of his name. But anyway, the point I'm trying to get across is I did the same thing he's telling you to do. I bought 18 houses cash. I never saw in my life to this day. I couldn't even take. And one time I was up in Cleveland for a convention of ours, like maybe 8, 9 years ago, and I called this real estate guy up and I said, "Look, I want you to sell all my houses. Where are they?" I said, "I can't tell you." He met me. Actually, I signed the guy up for the business. I met him in the lobby. And I signed a lease agreement on my house. He sold all my houses in like 45 days. And to this day, he still calls me. Hey, man, buy some. I've never seen him because this is what you do with your money.
Oh, you're talking about Beyond Win. Beyond Win.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah. Now, he's a great friend. Beyond is killing it, man. He's flipped thousands of homes in Cleveland. Yeah.
Yeah. And I still get it. I get an email every morning about some other investments because I like to buy apartment buildings. But here again, I moved on to a larger segment. So my money's making money while I'm doing network marketing. That's what I done with my money. I leveraged it and I buy other investments. Just like Mr. Jordan. Hey, tell them real quickly about the investment. Because last time we were in San Diego together, we went to that 8,000 square foot house you have right on the ocean. And we spent the night there. And I had a couple of who would I have come down? I had a couple of leaders in the area come over to that mansion.
I'll tell you the whole story. Yeah. So before I do that, though, I want to show you guys something. So I'm literally sitting in the forest right now. That's not a green screen behind me, but I am sitting in the forest right now. I want to show you guys something. This is the atrium in the entryway of my home. Can you guys see that?
Yeah.
So I got nature all around me here. So anyway, I'll share with you the story. So years ago, before I was making any money in network marketing, I had a dream that I wanted to have beach homes all over the world. And, you know, to buy a beach home, even back then, it was a $600,000 down payment, a big payment. My goal was to get beach homes in different places around the world and then maybe rent them out and then just go there when I wanted to go to these different places. Well, over a period of the next, as I started making money over the next 8 years or so, I'd go and everywhere I go, I'd get a real, you know, when I was near the beach, I'd get a realtor and we'd go look at houses, and every one of them was like $600,000 down. And then payment's going to be, you know, $8,000-$10,000 a month on these homes. And I'm like, man, it's going to take me forever to get these homes. I don't know if I can do this. This is probably not a great model. And I was really discouraged. I was in San Diego. I had just looked at four or five homes with a realtor on the beach. And I was kind of like down in the dumps about it, because I had this vision and this dream for like 15 years. And I went into the gift shop at the airport, the you know, concession place at the airport. And there's the magazine rack, and I'm looking, and there's something called the Rob Report that has all these beautiful multi-million dollar homes in it. So I buy one of those, and I get in the airplane, and I sit back in my seat, and I open this magazine, the Rob Report, and I open it to a page. Like, my goal was to have 30 multi-million dollar homes all over the world. I open the Rob Report to a page that shows pictures of 30 multi-million dollar homes on the beach. One page, and it says, own beach homes all over the world for $500,000. Own beach homes all over. So I call these guys, and when I called their office, they said, well, the guys are in Cancun right now, and they'll call you back when they get back. And I go, I'm going to Cancun in 2 days. I already had reservations to go. So I met with these guys in Cancun, and they told me about it. It was called Equity Estates. They're still around. It's a 12-year investment. It's not a timeshare. These are $3 to $5 million homes all over the world on beaches, usually anywhere from 5,000 to 20,000 square feet. And I went and I invested $500,000, and I owned equity in all 30 of these homes. So it was it's a total equity investment. It's not there's a separate management company. We own the homes. The investors own the homes. So for the next 12 years, we just liquidated the investment. But for the next 12 years, I got to use my homes. And I had a 5-bedroom home on the boardwalk in San Diego, a 7,000 square foot glass home on the beach in Tamarindo, Costa Rica. Everywhere, like all the nicest beaches of the world. And so we had my cousin's wedding at one of them. I had lots of retreats, all that kind of stuff. They're still around. So for the price of a down payment on one home, I got access. And by the way, in my second book, Better Than Beach Money, that Al held up, I have a chapter about equity estates in there, about how it works. I talk about it in that book. So by the way, both of my books are on Audible. So if you haven't, and I read them.
If you haven't, guys, get them, guys. Go get them, ladies and gentlemen. You know, that, and I came down to the Broadway. He was so funny. It was Julian Lewis. I had come over, his team. I said, meet me here. And there's about 10 of them, 8 of them that came over, blew their minds, like champagne ready for him and all. And as we were sitting on the deck, it's right on the beach. There's a walkway, and there's the beach right there. So it was, 2 seconds, you're in the water. And we were so funny. We're sitting there talking. Here come Kendall from Fresno walking down the Broadwalk, who blew his mind that we're right there. He's just walking by casually. But those are the things that business folks, I want you guys to get, hope this stretches your vision a little bit. You know, I want you to talk a little bit about, if you don't mind, Richard Branson.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's a little more to the story, Al, that you don't know, I think, but I have had, one of my dreams was to go to space. And I've never really told the rest of the story here, but I'll tell a little bit of it here.
Tell a little bit of it, not all of it. Tell a little bit of it.
There's a part of it that nobody knows. So I actually joined the Virgin Galactic Civilian Space Program to go to space. And as a result of that, I got lots of invitations. I've probably spent a total of 100 hours with Richard, many of those hours one-on-one, where I played chess with him and had breakfast, lunch, and dinner with him with a group of people, a small group, 12 people, on his island. And I've gone to the space launch where he went to space, and there were 100 media companies and 60 of us, you know. And so, and then, so I had it because I joined that program, which cost me $250,000. It actually, I mean, here's the thing: if you wanted to get an hour with Richard Branson online, just a one-on-one hour with him, probably cost you $100,000. So I paid $250,000 to go to space, and it included many, 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 many hours with Richard Branson. It didn't say that in the agreement, but I knew it. Not to mention, you get to network with all of his close family and friends. I was at his birthday party on one of his cruise ships where he hung out with us for a week, you know, all that kind of stuff. So, however, I have not gone to space. It's been 7 years since I joined that program, and I'm no longer in the program. I haven't told anybody this publicly until right now. I'm no longer in the program. And the reason I'm no longer in the program is it looks like it's going to be another 7 to 10 years before I go. And their stock went from $60 a share down to 76 cents a share. By the way, that's another place I invested money. It's not always about winning. You also lose, right? I invested a bunch of money in Virgin Galactic stock when it was at $60 a share, and now it's at 76 cents a share. Richard pulled out. He's no longer in the program, and it's still going, but it's plugging away. I don't think they're going to make it. They're going to need probably $4 billion more to continue to operate. And his last company, Virgin Orbit, which was not sending civilians into space, that company, he needed $126 million to keep it going, and he couldn't get it. So they laid off thousands of people. So I don't think it's going to make it. So I pulled my $250,000 out minus 25,000. So I had access to Richard Branson and got to know him and become friends for 25,000 bucks over a period of 7 years.
You know, what's important here, guys, see, a lot of times we have to be able to invest back into our futures, invest in books, invest in seminars, invest, invest, invest. And we get in and we're not willing to invest maybe even $1,000 into our future, like going to the international. And here he's talking about investing a quarter, and what he did 7 years ago, got his money back. Here again, but look what he got out of the return of that minus 25,000, all the hours he spent with Richard Branson. What is that worth? That's worth well more. And see, guys, I want you guys to understand, do not be afraid to invest in your future. God, this blows my mind. I mean, I'm investing in courses. I read 5 books a month. I'm investing in Al Thomas to make Al Thomas, you know, I want to go to 10 million a month, 10 million a year. I told you that. I can't do there if I'm sitting there making 3 or 4 or 5. I can't get there. I need to learn how to get there. I need to increase my skill level. And that's one thing I keep talking to you guys about. If you're stuck in the same freaking position year after year after, your skills is not going to get you there. What got you there today will not get you where you want to go. Does that make sense? So you got to increase your skill level, okay? And that's why I do these challenges and everything else I do to help you increase your skill level if you're coachable and willing to learn from somebody who's already got there, okay?
Lines. You don't need to invest $250,000 to gain the value that I got from that 25,000, right? If there's an opportunity to be VIP at an event for an extra $1,000, do that. Everything is better up front. Everything is better backstage. So if you have backstage access or VIP, who sits up front in the VIP? The people that are making things happen. People that are making things happen are sitting in VIP. So you want to be in VIP if at all possible. And if there is no VIP, you want to be the first to enter the room so you can sit up front. It's the front seaters that make the money. It's the front seaters that make things happen. So you want to make that part of your philosophy, part of your strategy. Sit up front. It's better up front. So one of the reasons I got to meet with Al and Jay and Meg Smith and Paul Orbison and Russ and Mary Nolan and all these people, the reason that I was able to be in that dinner, because every event before I'd ever made a penny, I'd sit up front and I'd take notes. Well, and then I'd do my best to get guests. And what would happen is I'd introduce the guests to the speakers. And the only people that really got to do that were the people sitting up front. So when you do that, that changes the game. Mm-hmm. So that's a really big thing. Anyway, sorry to interrupt, Al. Go ahead.
No, you didn't interrupt. I went to a seminar recently and paid a nice chunk of money, let's put it that way, not to, just because I can and I wanted to learn. So I paid it because I knew it was going to advance me, you know, 10x me. And I sat up front. And the first day and the second day, said the front seats are for the VIP who paid three times as much as I paid. But I went up there again and sat there again anyway. Like I felt I walked in like I was a VIP. See, a lot of times, that's right, Mr. Anderson, but you go as if. That's right, you go as if. And nobody said anything to me. And then I sat there the next day as a VIP, and they gave me lunch for free. But I sat there with the anticipation. I am a freaking VIP. What you talking about? But see, some of us go like, oh, I'm not a VIP. I better sit back here. No, if you go to a concert, where's the most expensive seats? The front freaking row. I call it the $1 million row. Right behind that, the $900,000, $800,000, $700,000, $600,000. I never want to sit there in the bleachers where you got these binoculars. I always sit up front. Guys, I walk in like I own the place. I don't walk in with scarcity. I love it.
Yeah, hey, tattoo on your forehead. Write this down. Everything is better up front.
That's right. Everything. Write that down. Danny Payne up in Alberta. Write that down. Everything is better up front. I mean, I like to, when I did go to concerts, but I don't go to concerts now, but when the singer opened their mouth, I could count their cavities and silver and gold teeth. I want to be so close. I want to smell their breath and make sure it's not bad because I want to get everything. The further away from you are from the truth, the less it sounds. And then you got people around you talking it and you can't hear what's going on. I want to hear everything. I've always been that way. So should you. You deserve it. Wow. Let's do this. We want to, if you don't mind, I want to treat him to what you and I talked about last week. We had a short conversation about this Ferrari deal.
Oh, dude, really? All right.
That's right. Don't have to. You don't have to.
No, I will. I will because there's some lessons. I learned some lessons. Definitely.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things that first I got to frame some things up before I go there. All right. Don't let me forget. But I want to frame some things up. Here's what's going on right now. This is big, you guys. This is really, really big and important for you to know. People are getting deluged. Everybody's starting a business and everybody's trying to sell everybody everything. And now with AI, it's going to be multiplied times 1,000. When most of us were kids, we'd get bombarded with 500 to 1,000 marketing messages a day. And today we're getting bombarded with tens of thousands of marketing messages, email distribution, scrolling on TikTok, all the stuff that we're getting. It used to be just billboards, television, and radio. Right now it's like it's in our face all day long, every day, and people are tired of it. They're feeling disconnected. The more connected we become, the more disconnected we become. And the more disconnected we become, the bigger the need for connection. And the people that are able to connect on a personal level, gratitude is the key. The people that are be able to connect on a personal level, they're the ones that are going to win. Gary Vaynerchuk says in one of his talks, he says, in the world of the Jetsons, the Flintstones are going to win. In the world of the, and because AI is going to, artificial intelligence is going to multiply it by 1,000. And people are done with it. They're done getting marketed to. You got to start expressing gratitude and appreciation to the people that you connect with. The people that, so they feel connected to you in real life terms. So let me share with you a story. 10 days ago, I have a condo at the Waldorf in Las Vegas on the Strip, and I'm there probably 10 days a month. On the 37th floor, looking south towards the MGM and the Luxor and New York and all that, look in that direction. I'm going to a charity event later in the afternoon and I get all dressed up and I go downstairs and the valet guys have parked my Toyota FJ in the circle drive downstairs. And I know all the valet and the concierge very well because I've been living there for 14 years. The valet guy hands me my keys. I get into my FJ and I start to drive out of the circle drive and I hear a crunch and I look around, look in my rearview mirror, look in my reverse mirror, all that, nothing. There's nothing around me. Like I'm looking over, there's nothing. So I go a little more and I hear crunch some more and I stop. And I realize there's something under my car. I feel like I'm running over something or crunching something underneath. So I get out of my car and I walk around and there's a $2.8 million Ferrari Enzo parked below my line of sight on the opposite side of my car, on the passenger side of the car, a $2.8 million Ferrari Enzo. And I'm like, I'm freaking out. Like my brain just went into a different place. You know, I just, and my blood and my heart and everything's like, I knew it was like, this is really, really bad. Well, the guy wasn't there when I did it. And the concierge was there and the valet. And I know these guys really well. And I said, look, you guys know the guy, please give him my number. I'm going to take care of everything. I've got insurance. Everything will be fine. I need to get his information, but I need to get to this charity event. So I left. 10 minutes later, I get a call from the building and from the management at the building, 10 minutes. And they say, you got to get your ass back here right away. The guy's really pissed and he's going to file a hit and run. So I turn around and I go back. And when I get back, this happened 10 days ago. There's a crowd of people around the car. And I drive up in my FJ and they all know I'm the guy that hit the $2.8 million Enzo Ferrari. And on top of that, the guy owned it for 2 days. And I don't even know why. I thought he was going to punch me in the face. He shook my hand. And he was pissed. He was really pissed. And I felt horrible, right? And I told him that. I said, everything's going to get taken care of. I'm sorry, blah, blah, blah. So they did all the stuff they needed to do. And then I left. Well, I needed to be in the mountains the next day. So I started driving early. I couldn't sleep that night at all. And at 3:30 in the morning, I got in my truck and I started driving to Arizona. And I got a text message at 3 o'clock in the morning from the guy whose car I hit. And he said, we need to meet for breakfast. Now I'm halfway to Arizona. He says, we need to meet for breakfast. And I text him back, said, Chris, I can't meet you. I'm halfway to Arizona. I got to be in Arizona. I'll meet you when I get back. But I said, I feel horrible. I lost sleep last night. You know, I feel terrible about it. Right. I sent that to him in message and he said, Jordan, this is how he texted me back. He said, Jordan, you don't need to feel terrible. You don't need to feel horrible. You don't need to lose sleep. It's just a car. I know you're going to take care of it. Everything's fine. We need to get together and get to know each other. So this guy's worth $100 million, sold a couple of technology companies. Let me tell you why that happened. Two reasons. One was I treat the people in the building like gold. I stop and I have conversations with them. I send them gifts over the holidays. I send them cards, all that kind of stuff. I treat them respectfully and like gold, like they're people. And because of that, they told him, Jordan is a really nice guy. You don't need to be mad at him. The staff did. Well, then there's a little more to the story. Check this out. Yesterday, I'm in the elevator getting ready to come down in Vegas, getting ready to come here again up in the mountains. And I run into this guy that's a good friend of mine. His name's Michael. And I've smoked cigars with Michael. I've been sending him stuff for gifts periodically. Every couple of years, I'll send him a gift for the past 10 years. We know each other really well. He's a multi-millionaire. He owns a big sports complex in Malibu. And I didn't know it, but he owned a lot of exotic sports cars. He brought up the car, me hitting the Ferrari. He brought it up. And I'm like, Michael, how do you know about that? Somebody tell you about it? He goes, no. He goes, I'm the guy that sold Chris the car. So the guy that I met in the elevator yesterday sold Chris the Ferrari 2 days prior to me hitting him. And Michael had a conversation with him and saying, Jordan's a good friend of mine. He you know, wouldn't hurt a flea, blah, blah, blah. He's a great guy. You need to get to know him. So that's why. And that is also the key to building your business successfully. So, he told me that they were going to, and until they found out Michael said something, they were going to do like, they're going to like replace the whole front of the car, but instead they repaired it. It was the difference between a $35,000 repair and a $7,000 repair. Michael said that if you were an asshole or if we didn't know you, we would have probably replaced the whole front of the car, which would cost you $35,000, but it cost me $7,000. So, yeah.
Wow. There is a good story. Folks,
you don't know what an Enzo Ferrari is. Put in Ferrari Enzo and see what comes up.
They're very rare, by the way. Very, very, very rare. You know, that's the difference being a jerk, $35,000, or being a nice person, $7,000. Right, guys? What did you learn from this exercise? What he said, the guy said, it's just a car. See, when you're in that kind of around those kind of people that have money, it's they don't take it personal. The emotions is not running crazy. He shook his hand. He said something else. And how do you treat people? He treats them like gold. Are people around you, do you treat them like gold? Let me give you a tip that I do every year, Christmas time. I give all the bankers, all my doctor, my doctor, his whole staff, everybody at the P.O. box, everybody that served me all year, I always give them candy, or I always give them a box of candy or something. I know the Fresno group, they go out and they give tamales to people or their customers. But what are you giving back? Look, with a closed fish, you can't give, receive. Every year they can count on me. Every year the homeless downtown, the homeless, I go down, you heard me say the other day, I take Brian Baker with me, my security guard. Sometimes when I start with my kids going out giving, what are you giving back? You know, we also take care of the people in Mexico, at our new place in Mexico, the whole staff down there that takes care of our place, Mr. Clemens, we take care of them. Guys, it doesn't take that much. And they go over and beyond the call of duty. Now, what if they did not know Jordan? What if Jordan did not tip? What if Jordan did not take care of? What if Jordan not take time to say hello to him and ask him how they are? Do you realize the position he's in because who he is? Does your reputation, write this down, does your reputation precede you before you get there? That's important. He sent out gifts. Wow. And that's the difference in a $35,000 versus a $7,000.
Hey, Al, I want to let you know that in 9 minutes, my doorbell is going to ring and I'm going to have to go because I've got a guy here to service my security alarm system.
Not a problem. We'll let you go in just in a minute or two. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you guys learned a lot. I got 3 pages full of notes. And today we're just going to talk, have a sit back talk. And I hope you guys got a lot out of it. If you take notes and then implement what you've learned today, because we're talking about a gentleman like me with 30 plus years experience in network marketing. Actually, 35 for me now, and he's about the same. But the whole idea, I hope you guys learned how you too can increase your income and how you can build a business for decades is going to give you residual income and take care of the rest of your life.